Well, Kim, it's not Monday.
It's not Monday.
It is Sunday.
What's happening?
And it is the 27th of December. We are almost at the end of the year.
Yep.
We are starting the fifth of our series of six with the culmination next week on Monday being the culmination of well-being. But today's topic is technology, and it's probably of all of the integral accounting topics that we discuss, the one that confuses people the most, and
yes.
So it's going to be highly likely that you're going to have some head-scratching moments where you go, oh, okay.
That was a technology.
That's a thing to think about. Hmm. But Kim, let's start with something fun.
All right.
Where are we sitting right now? Like, what's this?
We are sitting in the newly converted exercise / yoga studio that
yeah.
we created.
So, can you tell me what you do here? Like, what is it that you actually do in this?
Depends on the day, but it could be yoga. It could be a bit of Tracy Anderson. It could be
yeah.
Peloton.
Yeah, when you do Tracy
Pilates.
Anderson, what is Tracy Anderson here?
No.
How does she...
Tracy comes to me via a DVD.
A DVD. So you're still
yes.
using DVDs.
DVD. I am still using a DVD
okay.
player. Right
yeah.
here.
Yeah. So you're still using DVDs.
Mm-hmm.
That's good. So you exercise here.
Yep.
What was the thing that you did when we went out with Woofy for 2 miles before you
that
come
was,
down
that
here?
That was just a walk. We didn't count that as
it's
exercise.
Just a walk.
Yeah.
Yeah. So just so I get it straight. So we walk 2 miles every morning, which is not exercise.
We don't count it.
And then we come down here and we have the Peloton, we have the elliptical, we have
the
weight
range.
Rooms, you have the DVDs. So it's not exercise until you've touched technology. Is that what you're saying?
Pretty much.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
The old trick.
A little fun to get into today's conversation because we're going to talk about the fifth of our six series here, and we're going to talk about technology. And I'm going to take you on an interesting journey, which is one that is something deeply passionate to me. And I hope at the end of it, you think about this from the standpoint of what its implications are for you too. If we look through history, it is safe to say that for the majority of human history, technology has been the conscription of natural forces, of one form or another. And variously on the screen here, we have Vulcan. Not surprisingly, almost all of our places around the world that did innovation with things like metal, steel, forging, all those kinds of things, also have, somewhere in their geographic proximity, they have volcanoes. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty simple to realize that if you were living near a volcano, it was kind of self-evident that one way to make things that would be malleable or hard or so forth was to watch nature. And when you watch nature, and nature makes things like lava, and it makes things like obsidian, and makes all these kinds of amazing things, not surprising that you'd think that there is probably a god who figured out this thing called volcanology, named thusly for the god who figured that out. And so, not surprisingly, we have an enormous amount of smithing and forging and all of those kinds of things coming in places like Japan, parts of Asia, parts of the Asia-Pacific Ring of Fire, South America, parts of Italy, parts of the Mediterranean, and not surprisingly, the places that had smithing and forging were places that also had volcanoes.
Hmm.
That's a kind of a self-evident thing.
Yeah.
We have the story of Prometheus. Interestingly enough, the guy who actually goes and brings fire from the gods down to Earth and gets penalized for the rest of time. Interesting thing. Gets penalized being chained to a rock, having his liver eaten out by a vulture or by an
wow.
eagle or by some
intense
bird of some sort of prey. And he's penalized because he takes something which was thought to be the agency of the divine, brings it to humans. And so we have the technology of fire, which, not surprisingly, in cultures around the world, transformed the human experience because
sure
it kept the night at bay, mm-hmm. right? The idea of having a campfire, the idea of having a place to prepare food,
mm-hmm.
Tons of things that changed with the Promethean impulse to conscript fire into existence. Yeah. Helios, one of my favorite, the god of the sun. Solar power has been used in direct and indirect forms for a long time. We have the famous account of solar power being used as a defensive military technology in the Battle of Troy, where they polished the shield so brightly that they could actually focus light energy on wooden ships and burn them. Wow. Right? So early lasers. Kind of cool. But you see in Egyptian iconography, you see in South American iconography, people that have solar disks on their heads. We actually don't know what those were for, whether they symbolize something or whether they were actually a technology. But one way or another, we know that the sun and the moon played a very important technological role in what we see as civilization. Interestingly enough, one of the few that seems to consistently across almost every civilization be a woman is Terra or Gaia, the female representation of Earth. Earth energy being fertility, being stability, being shelter, being all of those kinds of things, but also being things like seismology. Not surprisingly that you'd pick a woman to be kind of cataclysmic with. No, I'm kidding. So you have this goddess energy around the earth and the fertility and the productivity of the earth and all of the things that are both wonderful and supporting and sustaining of life, but also things that can get way out of hand really quickly, like mudslides and erosion and all sorts of other things, dust storms. You can think of all of the things that come into the way in which the earth was one of those core technologies that humans conscripted.
Yep.
The next one, fifth one, the wind. It's interesting when we think about this. I've contemplated when I think about a bird learning to fly. Does a bird and a fish have a different experience? Because does a bird actually think of itself as swimming through the fluidity of the air? Because why not? We have no idea whether they know that they're swimming just in a different density. But the idea of flying versus swimming all rely on the fluidity of the aerodynamics and hydrodynamics of what happens with the wind and with the air. And we have used wind power, whether it's to move ourselves across the seas, whether it is to power the mills and grind the grain, do all those sorts of things, to pollinate crops. Tons of places where we've used the wind as a technology, and finally water. Not surprisingly, seen both as the sustainer of life, but also the depriver of life. It's very easy to see how essential water is in terms of its ability to use its buoyancy and its properties to actually use those for locomotion, use those for animation of power and the idea of water wheels and all kinds of other things where water was conscripted into technology that humans used. But at the same time, horrible uses of water too. Torment, torture, torment, drowning, executions, you name it. So water has, like all of the other elements, this kind of both very interesting, very positive, very constructive use as a technology, but also a very negative use. And it's very interesting that up until approximately the 15th century, everything I have on the screen here was the sum and substance of technology. One form or another, whether it's sailing ships, whether it's weapons, whether it's anything else, all of them were born of the conscription of one of the primal kind of core technologies of our human experience, whether that be cosmic, whether that be terrestrial, whether that be the kind of the chaos of fluid dynamics, one form or another, up until the 15th century, that was technology.
Interesting that there's six.
Now, what's fascinating about this as technology, as I reflected on this, is that up until the 15th century, our experience of technology was that which just was conscripted to the things that we wanted to actually use it for. But the forces, the energies, the things that were in fact out there just were, right? We didn't make the wind and then go sailing. We actually observed the wind and then said, hey, we can harness that.
Use that, yeah.
Right? And so we have these kind of six primal forces or six primal experiences, which animated almost all of technology up until the 15th century. But 15th century, what happened in the 15th century where technology seems to have changed? And not just any time in the 15th century, right around 1439 or 1440, nobody knows for sure, but a business failure that was a business failure about coming up with all kinds of interesting technologies around metal, the forging, smithing, alloying of metal, turned into what one could argue was potentially one of the most consequential technologies that actually took us down the pathway to the world we find ourselves in right now. And that is Gutenberg's printing press. Prior to Gutenberg's printing press, the way in which we communicated was usually to take scribes who either reproduced or drew or essentially were stenographers, and they'd take a record of a thing, and then, you know, Bob would write it down, and then Sue would copy it over here, and somebody else would copy it, and before long, you'd have a few copies of a thing. All of a sudden, between 1440 and 1454, you have this amazing thing happen where suddenly language, words, become mass-produced. Possibly one of our first experiences, certainly in the Occident, of having a technology lead to something called mass production. Outside of the agrarian world, this was actually one of the big, big, big breakthroughs. But, not surprisingly, with that breakthrough, immediately came a threat to an incumbent power. In this case, the church, the clergy, and the royalty that were supported by the church and the clergy. And all of a sudden, the idea that anybody could get information was a dangerous proposition. And within a few short years, it became a capital offense to print certain things, where if you printed certain things that were the domain of experts, you actually were executed.
Wow.
Isn't it interesting that the birth of a new and highly disruptive technology didn't just lead to the proliferation of ideas and concepts, but it also led to a horrific experience of human suppression leading to massive, massive allegations of heresy and allegations of conspiracy theories and allegations of all sorts of unapproved narratives getting out into the public. And in a few short years, listen to this, people, took us about 18 years to go from a core platform technology to the erasure of humanity, the literal execution of people by virtue of the threat they represented to society. Keep that in mind. 2 decades after the introduction of technology, it becomes used as the basis for exterminating the voice, exterminating human impulse, and exterminating human life.
Yeah.
Pretty amazing when we carry this forward to, are you ready for this? Electricity. Now we're jumping forward to the 19th century. 19th century, we start recognizing this wonderful thing where static electricity and dynamic electricity start to be played with, and we get into the 19th century. Quite fascinating. One of the very first uses of electricity in terms of the public propaganda was the execution of an elephant. An elephant executed for murder at a circus. Now, what makes this particular story so fascinating is an elephant actually did step on a person and the person died. But what this was an opportunity in the Westinghouse Edison fight to try to show the public how powerful a thing was. So they used electricity to execute an elephant to prove the point that this technology was so powerful, right? If it could kill a big animal, then that's a great thing. At the turn of the last century, not surprisingly, electric cars were actually more economical and more viable than, are you ready for this? Gas-powered cars. Isn't it interesting that while we celebrate Tesla and we celebrate all these kind of hybrid vehicles now,
been around a while.
120 years ago, those vehicles were actually more viable in terms of their technological readiness than an internal combustion engine.
Wow.
We actually had faster electric vehicles 120 years ago than we had gas-consuming vehicles 120 years ago. Amazing to think about this. But in the short time of Edison and Westinghouse fight to take the idea of electricity and bring it into a common use, which, by the way, didn't become generalized to every consumer until we stopped burning oil for light, and we started lighting cities with electrified lights, and we started changing everything because we could start metering it. See, electricity wasn't the technology that was interesting. The ability to get people addicted to a thing that they needed to pay for every month, that was what finally made electricity the dominant animating force. But remember, within that short two-decade period of time, electricity became the agency of capital punishment. We kill people based on that particular innovation. And just to keep the theme going, let's think about DNA.
Yeah.
Let's think about life. Let's think about the now advances in augmented reality and computation and semiconductors and so forth. And it took us, are you ready for this? Virtually no time to figure out that digital, whether digital was represented by semiconductors and silicon chips and wafers, or whether digital was represented by the stretching out of chromosomes, the defiling of human life, pulling the chromosomes down to their alleged, you know, double helix, which is nothing more than a ferromagnetic tape model of human life, which is not what human life is. But we took this unstretched chromosome and we stretched it all out and we simplified it down to something that we think we can understand. And within not even two decades here, we turned the agency of what we knew to be genetics into the technology of sophisticated, world-class eugenics.
Yes.
Isn't it amazing that it took us less than 20 years from the advent of a thing to the weaponization of a thing? In each one of these stories, we can't even make it a full generation before the technology that we build turns into what warfare is now.
Yeah.
Which is, hey, we can have somebody sitting in Las Vegas with a joystick controlling a drone over some anonymous place in the Middle East, and we can hit a button and we can blow people into oblivion and go get a hamburger for lunch.
Yeah, it's insane. Right?
Isn't it amazing that our story with technology is really interesting? Because what we've done with technology is we've actually taken what used to be nature conscripted for our utilization. And remember, we had wind when we needed to move things. We had water when we needed pressure and we needed to use gravitational energies. We had volcanism when we wanted to change materials. We had fire when we wanted to alter our living conditions or when we wanted to alchemicalize the ways in which we experienced food and whether we experienced materials and whether we experienced all sorts of other natural phenomenon that we adapted for our convenience. In each one of those cases, we had a host of options of what were the animating sources that we were going to use as technology. And over the period of time from 1440 until now, we've taken that range and shrunk it and shrunk it and shrunk it and shrunk it. Until now, we don't even think of a thing as a technology unless it's electronic, unless it is plugged into a grid, unless it is connected to a network. We simply don't have a framework to think of technology with as sophisticated a view as the Greeks and the Romans two millennia before. Yeah. Isn't it interesting that we've said we've advanced, but we haven't advanced? No, in fact, we've gone the opposite way. What we've done is we have built an over-reliance on an ever-narrowing set of components of technology. Where now, health is not vitality. Health is something that you measure with a computer. You measure with chemistry.
Not how you feel anymore.
It used to be. Health was measured by, can you take Wofigus on a 2-mile walk? Can you come downstairs and do yoga? Can you actually engage in a living, breathing, dynamic ecosystem in which your body and your mind and your entire intellect and your sphere of influence is all healthy and dynamic? Now, your health is determined by what a computer says. Your movements are determined by what a computer says. Mm. Your ability to board an aircraft, your ability to go across a state line, your ability to do anything is now adjudicated through an ever-narrowing set of variables. And unfortunately, the area of technology has lost what in fact technology is. Because technology is the ability to conscript resources for consensus experience. Mm. Let me say that again. The ability to conscript resources for a consensus experience. Now, that's what technology's been for thousands of years. But what we've done now is we have defined technology as the agency through which experience must happen. Do you see the insidious nature of this? We went from, hey, we want to have an experience, let's conscript the energies, let's conscript the universal principles that are around us, and let's deploy those to actually have an effect. Now we say, here's the stage on which life is going to happen. It's going to be electrified. It's going to be digital. It's going to be computerized. It's going to be overseen by unseen hands. Mm-hmm. It's going to be metered. You're going to have to pay for the utility of the experience. And then your experience is going to be subject to the curated energy and the curated data and the curated operating systems upon which you're told to have an experience. It's kind of staggering.
Very much.
And by the way,
it's not advanced.
How long has Facebook been around? Oh, that's right. About 2 decades. And guess what's happened? Mm-hmm. In 2020, Facebook has now been turned into a weapon that is adjudicating whether or not people live or die.
Yep.
Absolutely amazing. Amazing that we, despite all of the Moore's Law's principles about how everything accelerates and all of this grand speeches about what technology is going to enable and what technology is going to bring us and the fact that we're living in an information technological age, we are worse off right now in 2020 than we were when we actually had all 6 elements of nature. And we knew how to use them. Mm-hmm. We now are clueless on how to use almost all of them. Yeah. And our grandparents or our great-grandparents remembered a world mm-hmm. where the wind was actually something that you celebrated because it helped do a thing. Water was something that you wanted to have on your property, not a thing that came out of a faucet. You wanted to have something where water was interacting with gravity so that you could power a wheel and you could do things. And it turns out that in less than 3 generations, we have now chained ourselves to metered experience rather than an analog celebration of the human experience animated by technology that allows us to conscript resources at liberty.
Yes.
Amazing. So what are the problems? The problems are we're now trapped in an illusion where ideas start with a precondition. An idea only is an idea if it can be an app on a phone. Hmm. It's only an idea if it can be done on a computer. It's only an idea if it's aided by computer programs. It's only an idea if it is reliant on data. We don't have a picture of what the world would look like if ideas were in fact a plurality of analog experiences. They are all now reduced to, I've got to have a computer, I've got to have data, I have to have a phone, I have to have electricity, and if I don't have those things, it's not technology. Tragically, almost all of our technologies, in one form or another, are animated inside of a cultural context of death. Don't think for a minute that the internet that you think you use for free wasn't in fact based on the ARPANET, which was in fact a defense technology and a defense platform, just like the cell phone you use, just like the radio transmitter that you have, just like the analog to digital conversion that once upon a time was how we did acoustics and film. Now, all of those things based on detectors, CCDs, other forms of electronics, all of which have their roots in warfare and death. Transdisciplinarity, meaning that now everything has to pass through a common portal. Rather than having the plurality of the six primal forces and primal technologies, we now have a forced mentality that says that for technology to exist, it must pass through the common filter of electronics and computation.
Yes.
And if it doesn't do that, there's something not technical about it. Our only business model is utility. We can only figure out how to charge for how you access a thing by the frequency with which you access it. Right now, people are talking about the fact that they're not going to be able to travel because there's going to be COVID passes and vaccination records and online things. Well, here's an idea. For thousands of years, we have traveled. You know how we've traveled? We've traveled in automobiles for 100 years. We traveled before that in carriages and conscripting animals and conscripting other life forces. We actually, once upon a time, had bicycles that had two wheels that we pedaled, and they actually went someplace. They weren't Peloton, where you sit and you pedal for 9 miles equivalent, and you've moved absolutely nowhere. Utility is, in fact, not based on a metered system only. Utility is whether or not there's a value for having the experience, which leads us to the technology of experience, which now we are giving to people as a augmented experience of experience rather than the actual experience. Right now, I can go on my Peloton in the gym room just over there, and if I want to, I can hit a button that will allow me to ride on virtual scenes. I can pick a European village. Ooh. I can pick a Alpe d'Huez or whatever, some sort of, you know, Tour de France ride. I can pick rides that I can do from the comfort of Charlottesville, Virginia, rather than actually going, God forbid, to someplace else and experiencing it. So guess what Kim and I are going to do to have our analog experience? We're taking a week off of Peloton, and we're going to actually be putting Strava segments on, and we won't tell you where, but if you're following us,
you'll see.
But we're going to actually see if we can ride against the wind. We're going to try to see if we can get some sun. And rather than having the digital experience on Peloton, we're going to have some analog experience flying along the coast. Unfortunately, the current model of technology is based also on an aspiration, where to have is to have identity. If I don't have a thing, if I don't have access to a thing, then I'm somehow lesser than. If you look at the Millennium Development Goals, you'll see that the vast majority of Millennium Goals are defined by the absence of a thing rather than the presence of a thing. It's a bunch of people who sit at New York galas and identify all the things that civilized people, wealthy people, you know, developed people have, and then taking that list say, oh, here these poor unfortunate souls over here don't have those things. Not once have those exact same people gotten out of their black ties and their gowns and gone and lived with the communities and said, oh my gosh, you have technologies which in fact are not susceptible to electromagnetic pulses. You have technologies that in fact are not requiring the pharmaceutical industrial complex to keep you allegedly healthy. You have technologies that actually have ways of making sure that the vitality of your life and the vitality of your community are maintained. No.
That's real living.
Millennium Development Goals are about telling other communities and other cultures what they don't have, and then saying to meet a threshold of development, you have to get rid of the things that give you resilience and vibrancy, which leads us to what technology could and should be. Technology could and should be the energy of information, access, and equivalence, where we start seeing the world through all of the lenses of all of the animating forces and energies and get back to a period of time where we're having the facility to conscript those to actually give us a shared community experience. Rather than animated by death, we should actually be looking at trusted networks where I can look at somebody like Craig Ernst, my dear friend up in Strasburg, Virginia, who, when I need to understand how to make a part or make a piece of furniture or mill a piece of wood, I actually have to go and speak to and interact with a person who has mastered woodworking and metalworking and understand how to interact with materials in a way that is actually something that gives me confidence and gives him confidence, because I'm relying on the trust and the experience that he's built with mastering the elements.
Yes.
We could think of a world where experiential diversity, the ability to make sure that we don't rely on an expert credentialed by books and the literature coming out of the Gutenberg press model of the 15th century. No, I'd much rather have somebody working with and interacting with me who's not trained based on books and words, but has been trained based on experience.
Yes.
The ability to interact with the living system, the ecosystem, the world of finance, the world of philosophy. I'd rather have the interactivity rather than having somebody whose credential is based on digital knowledge regurgitation alone.
Absolutely.
Rather than having utility-only value, which meters things independent of their ultimate use, we should think of scalar value metrics. What is something really worth, right? Is the same outlet in a house next to a refrigerator and the same outlet sitting next to, I don't know, a growing light to grow vegetables or grow something indoors, is that same outlet the same thing? Is a faucet in a kitchen and the faucet in a guest bathroom worth the same amount? Well, no. Just because the utility has common elements doesn't mean that each one of the experiences of that utility is in fact the same. We need to think about utilities in scalar value, not in a base commodity utility model alone. We need to think of regenerative utilities, things that actually not only have the ability to work, but in their working have the ability to prime the system to work again. Not something that makes everything an energetic cul-de-sac, where once the electron has been spent, once that piece of energy has been expended, it is actually extinguished and doesn't have the ability to do anything else. We should be thinking about what technologies we can use that have regenerative capacities, where the spring gets reloaded metaphorically and really having the ability to be used and then used again and then used again. So that ultimately we and nature interact with engagement at liberty. When you think of technology, think about the old definition of technology, the capacity to conscribe the resources of the universe for the consensus and shared experience of others. And then ask yourself on this last week of 2020, on a week that gives us the opportunity to reflect on how much we've lost our humanity by virtue of an ever-narrowing definition of technology.
Yep.
Right? With all due respect, the RT-PCR as a tool is interesting. It is interesting. And when it was invented as an interesting piece of research technology. Nothing right or wrong with it. But when we decided to take something developed for one thing and bring it into an ever-narrowing definition, where ultimately what we have is a world where our health is adjudicated on a technology that has no idea what health is.
Yep.
It never had an idea of what health is. It never can have an idea of what health is, because health is a multifaceted analog experience. It is not a delivered experience in some sort of virtual reality curated by Atlanta or by Fort Detrick or by any other place in any federal lab. The fact of the matter is health is adjudicated by whether or not we can actually take Woofy for a walk for 2 miles.
Absolutely.
And then come downstairs and exercise. So here's the challenge for you. Pick one thing this week. I don't care what it is. And explicitly unplug. Unplug. Seriously. Like, cook over an open fire.
Mm.
Just try it. See if you can see if you can just boil water once over a fire. See if you can still
figure out
how to light a match.
Yeah.
Right? See if you can move something that you were going to move with a lever and a fulcrum rather than with a winch or a hoist.
Something unelectronic.
Do something this week. Just practice. Yeah. See if you can stretch the muscles that for at least 7 or 8,000 years all of our ancestors did. Stretch a muscle. Use the forces of nature and see if you can have an unplugged experience going into 2021 that will emancipate you from the addiction and the control of a technology that is now on the precipice of bringing about the next genocide in our society. The genocide of the human intellect, the genocide of human creativity by the extermination of anything that is not augmented reality. See if you can relight the fire. Be Prometheus. Go to the gods, grab the fire, and come back.
Burn, baby, burn.
And burn, baby, burn. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, everyone.
And we'll see you again in 2021.
Yes.
Have a beautiful, beautiful New Year's Eve, New Year's Day celebration. And wherever you are, unplug.
Absolutely. Bye, everyone.